U-L-L-E-D yourself by your own bootstraps, who have all made the right connection on your own. For those of you who have already moved up on the east side with George and Wheezy. For all of you out there who have friends whose fish don't fry in the kitchen and whose beans don't burn on the grill. For all of you who think not talking about problems mean they don't exist, you are confused if you believe justice has arrived for all of us in these yet to be United States. I think the death of Trayvon Martin has reminded us that our fight for justice is ongoing and requires vigilant spirits, requires that we continue to stand up and speak out. Henderson uses the cultural trauma of the killing of black boys to magnify to her hearers that she is a black person as well as a woman, which gives her a unique experience. Henderson announces to her congregation that as a pulpiteer and a black woman, this gives her the authority to speak candidly about the cultural trauma of seeing another young black boy killed senselessly. What she does in the sermons is that she encourages her audience to, quote, interpret and receive the word through the lenses of your own experiences as a child or youth or as a new believer or as a well-versed biblical scholar. As a Methodist, she also uses that Wesleyan quadrilateral that talks about scripture, experience, reason, and I'm gonna call the other one in a minute. For the United Methodist and United Methodist tradition, faith at its core was revealed by scripture, illuminated by tradition, verified by personal experience, and conformed by reason. As she begins to take on her Moses persona, many African Americans believe the way that preachers approach the text is that they believe that God is an all-powerful one who is unquestionably present in the scriptures. This sovereign God attends to their protection and well-being in a myriad of ways daily. The quote, the word of God informs us and our life experiences, reforms the text to make them relevant to our experiences and relevant to our beliefs and social location. In other words, the word in its universal application can also speak specifically to a particular situation. In other words, Henderson is helping the audience to understand that scripture can and will help them come to grips with the recent deaths of Trayvon Martin and to set in motion a relevant response by the congregation. Through the sermon, Henderson parallels the thirsty experience of the Israelites during the Exodus with the thirst for justice. She recounts the difficulty of the Israelites who had been in the desert for an extended length of time and who have been frustrated with their leader, Moses. The people are thirsty. They have been without an adequate supply of water. And with dry throats and parched lips, people become desperate. And when they become desperate, they begin to act in ways that can hurt themselves. In the story of Exodus, they can hurt themselves by returning to Egypt, and they can hurt others, Moses. And when people become desperate and thirsty today, as in the death of Trayvon Martin, George Zimmerman was thirsty for something, but then he acted in ways that killed Trayvon Martin. Henderson compares the convenience of carrying a bottle of water with the desperation of people who do not have access to water to quench their thirst. And Henderson turns to the desperation felt by thirsty Israelites who began to question the authority of their leader, Moses, and began to threaten his life. Henderson does not leave the hearers hopeless, thirsty, and in a place with no relief. Deepening the metaphor of thirst, Henderson connects a thirst for justice in the death of Trayvon Martin with the Israelites' thirst for water. Henderson exclaims the good news in the Exodus text is that the hearers, like the Israelites, can call on the name of the Lord in desperate times. Just as God provided water for thirsty and desperate Israelites, God will provide relief for a community who is thirsty for justice. In her Moses persona, three things occur. First, she, like Moses, asked the Lord, what is she to do with a group of people who have become comfortable and complacent in their faith and in their lifestyle? What is she to do with a group of people who are sitting down when injustice is occurring in the streets daily? How is she going to lead a group of people who are older than she is and may threaten her role in the congregation if she continues to agitate the congregation? And if you all ever feel threatened when you want to do something radical for the people, do you ever feel like if I say this, if I do this, then they gonna kick me out and nobody's gonna go with me? And you asking, Lord, is this the right thing to do? I think the Lord says through scripture in Exodus 17 and 5, quote, go on ahead of my people. Henderson informs the congregation that they are going to lead the community in the quest for justice. Furthermore, God has called us for such a time as this. This recalls a salient moment in the story of Esther when her uncle Mordecai reminds her that God has placed her in her current position to do something remarkable for the Jewish people. This must have been an arresting moment in her sermon preparation time, that scripture was affirming and confirming what she was to do as a leader in the congregation. Henderson is to lead the congregation in a quest for justice in the community. After being affirmed and confirmed by God through scripture, Henderson is to help the people to learn how to respond if they are going to move ahead with her in the fight for justice. Immediately, she offers a way out for people who don't really want to go. A reason and rationale for not participating in the movement towards justice. She goes back to scripture and cites what God told Moses. Quote, take some of the elders with you. Henderson then lists the qualifications for those that need to go with her. They need to be seasoned, level-headed, faithful, committed, and disciplined. Henderson's final instruction is to help the people who are willing to go forth in the fight for justice is not going to require anything new or novel. God told Moses to use what he had, his staff, to benefit all of Israel. Therefore, the congregation is to use what they have for the benefit of all of humanity. When they commit to that, God will use God's power to do something miraculous. Henderson desires to lead her people from a state of being thirsty for justice to going to the rock Jesus, where justice can be realized. In her closing, Henderson offers reassurance despite the difficult news of Trayvon Martin's murder and other injustices. She reminds them that persons of faith are required to have perseverance in order to forge ahead with God. And members are urged to watch God turn disappointment, heartbreak, injustices around to favor the marginalized and oppressed. At the end of any sermon, often you will begin to find what people really, really believe in the sermon. At the end of her sermon, she says, despite the pain and disappointment, I know deep in my soul that God is on our side. Despite how things look right now, I know that God is working it all out. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, we have already come. We've already come too far to turn back now. Through these three women preachers I've examined, they're from different eras, from different faith traditions, and likely age. They share an underlying current of resistance to the status quo and a charge to move forward. Rhetorically, they use these personas of advisor, wise teacher, or Moses to create a sense of authority within the text for their audience. They've all used anaphora as a way to repeat and anchor their sermons. But one of the things that's interesting is that each of these sermons could be considered social activist sermons. Social activist preaching agenda is concerned about poverty alleviation, racial and gender equality, and all peace, justice, and economic struggles. Although Harkness' methodology was subversive in the way that she co-opts the language of gentle and quiet spirit, alternatively, the sermons of Henderson and Murray were very candid and matter of fact. They were in your face. I think part of the rationale could have been the historical time in which they proclaimed these sermons. What I found interesting was that each of them seemed to view Jesus as being with the people, and that's really important. These preaching women spoke in authentic, radical words of justice, inclusion, and provided holistic roles for women both in the church and in society. These preachers spoke to the complex character of women. They were candid in their critique of oppression, sexism, patriarchy, and how it plays out in our society and within the church. And more compelling within each of the sermon was a biblical thread of a united humanity that seeks justice and wholeness for everyone. As I reflected on each of the sermons, I wish I could have heard them live, right? I wondered if the congregation was eerily quiet through Murray and Henderson's sermon. However, we do get a small echo of the audience response to Henderson, whose sermon closes with, I heard somebody say, yeah! And to all of them, I say, yeah, which is keeping with the call and response of the African-American sermons. When I think about my own theology of preaching, one of the things that came out to me, unbeknownst to me at the outset, they resonated with me in my own hermeneutic and persona of preaching. As I shared earlier, I usually take on a persona of preacher, scholar, and fellow traveler of the faith. And when I reflect upon the current challenges facing America and the world, I believe that African-American preaching can produce a spiritual revival that will call forth women and men to take radical and rhetorical liberating positions. Preaching can name the evils and offer an appropriate response. Grounded in the liberating message of the gospel, 21st century preaching must offer challenges, opportunities, and ways to our hearers to become engaged in the life of the communities where they live, where they learn, where they work, where they worship, and where they play. While strides are still being made to recognize that women preachers are equal to that of men, there is still room to grow. We can grow in the intentional selection of women to lead our congregations, having women preaching more often from our pulpits, and not just on special occasions, such as Women's Day or Mother's Day. And having women involved in the ecclesial decisions of local congregations, global faith, and para-faith organizations. When we men unintentionally or intentionally exclude women, we are missing half of the divine creation in our lives and in the life of our church. Questions. What did you hear?
The mass.
The mass? Okay. Thank you.
I didn't think about it like that, but that's true. Hmm. I think what kept coming back to me, even as you were closing, is just the importance of recognizing that everyone has a voice. Mm-hmm. And that to be the body of Christ, we need to be intent on hearing that voice, however that may be. Even as you were sharing about women, children have a voice.
Yes.
How do we hear them, and how do we hear youth, and how, you know what I'm saying? Just mm-hmm. opens a broader discussion of, are we listening to the voices that God has placed to help direct us to justice, direct mm-hmm. us to whatever that may be, you mm-hmm. know?
Yes. And are we putting them in positions to hear them?
Exactly.
Or do we want to treat our children as trophies and examples, like you just stay in your place, I don't need to hear from you, as if a child cannot offer critique, criticism, and opportunity for us as adults. Mm-hmm. Anything else you've heard? Was this helpful? So as we begin to close, I just want to thank y'all for coming out today. It has been a great joy for me to do this. And so throughout the rest of my study, I will continue to offer these kinds of opportunities to come and teach and help others not only unpack sermons, but also how to become better speakers in the ways that they want to become that at no cost to y'all. All right. So thank you. I appreciate you. All right.